they were having trouble with the black troops in the town. Most of it was from white American soldiers not wanting the black soldiers there, because the Australian girls were welcoming these black soldiers. They were sort of like heroes coming in to help win the war or help defend Australia at that time.
They were told not to mix with us. That's what the problem was. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, we fraternized and we're friends, you know. As a matter of fact, some guys married Australian girls.
I know many a times I'm walking down the street with Eileen and get stopped by the shore patrol wanting to know, let's see your pass. And while they're looking at your pass and everything, one will slide up to the other and say, if I had him back home, I'd make a white man out of him. Well, see, there's not much you can say. Somebody got a 45 on and billy clubs and there's three of them and all that. They were just nasty to the black troops.
The white MPs, the military police of the Americans, used enormous amount of force and violence against the Afro-American troops, a lot of whom in this particular time come from the North. They're not Southerners, so they're not going to accept this intense racism. They're not going to accept being batoned, threatened, shot.
The build-up of tension between white and black American troops reached boiling point and exploded with a series of violent clashes on the streets of Brisbane.
There's a series of riots that occur in South Brisbane between the 11th and the 24th of March 1942, and they are purely within the American forces.
After the Brisbane riots, the Queensland government demanded the Americans take decisive action.
After the big riot, the Queensland government then puts pressure on the American authorities to have black Americans taken out of the main urban centre. And it's at this time they're then sent to places like Mount Isa and Camarwheel, Ingham and Townsville.
We got to Townsville, we got off the train, and then I guess it was prearranged that we were going to the racetrack, so we convoyed to the racetrack and set up our camp in the racetrack.
Some of the black units were stationed in remote bush locations, where they had to deal with not only the isolation, but with the hot, dry, and inhospitable conditions. In Charters Towers, a unit was camped on a property that now belongs to Harold Lavery, who clearly remembers the American presence.
Well, it was on the left-hand side of the road going to town from our place, and there was a mob of Negroes camped there. Well, they were camped there for a good while. Just a heap of tents and vehicles, and it was a black camp. You see the black fellas getting about. But no enjoyment or any entertainment went on in them camps. It was just home to camp and work to do. They'd go to town at night and have the entertainments, and that's where we seen that trouble that night.
Well, we were in the bar at the Excelsior. Oh, geez, they took to a black fellow there with a bat, and they talk about the blood coming out of him. Yeah, the MPs took to him.
And they were doing no harm to anybody. More buggers. They never caused any trouble in the bar.
There are rumours in small towns throughout Queensland of black American soldiers being shot and killed by white Americans. Some of the accounts are reliable, but none appear in any official military records.
In Mount Isa, I interviewed some men who were engineers who worked for Mount Isa Mines, and they were professional men. They were already older. They were in their 40s, so they're quite reliable informants. And one of them saw an altercation between three black American servicemen and white MPs over black Americans going into a hotel to drink and asking the barmaid out for a date. the white MPs didn't like this because they think that it broaches the colour line. There's a fight, they go outside, and several informants said they saw a white MP shoot one of the black Americans. And as they said, just bundled his body up and threw it in the back of a truck, and that was all they heard of it. So Australians were absolutely shocked when they saw this, absolutely appalled.
There was a group of American Negroes who were to build an airfield out on what is underneath the waters of the now Ross River Dam. And they built this, they built it by hand. The American Negroes, they were just confined to the camp there. They just weren't allowed out. And apparently they revolted, and they were heading over to the railway line that leads through to Charter Towers, and they were going to come into town for some rest and relaxation.
The men stormed toward town, determined to have a good night out, but were met by a group of white soldiers and officers. They were locked up and kept under close guard. Jaime Samuelson decided to get his men out of the stockade, but records how he met with stiff resistance from fellow white officers.
Over 100 of our men had been rounded up by white soldiers armed with bayonets and loaded guns. A corporal thrust a cocked rifle at me. When I stopped his truck and gave instructions to his Negro prisoners on the back of it. After this, I loaded my own revolver.
Rumors were rife in Townsville about the extent of the violence.
The story I got was that the white American just turned the machine guns on them, and that was it. That was end of story.
As the train pulled in, of course, you got the whites and the blacks. And the white could get off and use the restaurants and everything like that. And black American had to stay on the train. Must have been a dozen of them started to get off the train, and they were running towards the shop. And this white American MP just yelled out, "Stop, nigger, stop, nigger." Pulled his pistol out and just shot the nearest one to him. We were just dumbstruck.
Here rest the remains of Americans who came to these shores. This is one corner of the Australian land that is forever America. Rest well, men of America, whose lives were dedicated to liberty.
Millions of troops were sent to the Pacific Islands to push back the Japanese. The men weren't prepared for the difficult jungle conditions, constant air raids, and enemy fire. Many black soldiers weren't even issued rifles to protect themselves if they came face to face with the Japanese.
I was on guard duty first. I didn't have a weapon, had a club in my hand. And you know, here it is, my turn was 12 o'clock at midnight, and we could hear the Japanese voices, black Yankee, why you fight? They don't want you in USA, why you fight? Go home. Say, we your friend, you know, that type of thing. All I had was a club. Yeah, if they had known, if they only had known, they just didn't know, they just assumed we all had weapons.